This is a 10-man podcast hosted by me, Chris Tinius. I'm a former college soccer coach and avid music fan. Many episodes will have a hand in one or both of those topics, but we'll also delve into entrepreneurship, leadership, and other subjects. Basically, this podcast is my way to reconnect with old friends, get new perspectives, and help others share their own stories, passions, and expertise. Now let's get started with the 10-man podcast. Welcome to the 10-Man Podcast. I'm Chris Tinius, and I appreciate you taking the time to listen. My guests in this episode are Nick Nguyen and Scott Johnson from Bonepony. Nick was my first musical guest at the beginning of last season. This time, he's back with his longtime bandmate and founder of the group. Scott shares about the origins of the band, they both discuss the re-release of Stomp Revival, and even play a couple of songs. So let's get straight into it with Scott and Nick playing Where the Water's Deep.
This one's about being empty inside and needing to get filled up. It's called Where the Water's Deep.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh, yeah, yeah. Well, there's a mean old man, he's got a mean old wife. They got four grown kids and a wealthy life. Uh-huh, yeah. Guess that's the way it goes, yeah, yeah. He's spent 47 years in a butcher's shop. He spends his $100 pictures on his bed. Guess that's the way it goes. Sometimes he thinks back to the times he had, but always gives me the way his wife went mad. Well, it feels used up like money spent, like a wet tongue sucking on a peppermint. Can't you hear him crying out a soft command? Take me down where the water is deep, down to the river where the water's sweet. Feel myself on your desert sand. Fill it up again. Take me down where the water's deep, down to the river where the water's sweet. Jack's long drive on the desert sun. I need filling up again. There's a young girl looking for a brighter fate than pouring coffee for the truckers off the interstate. Guess that's the way it goes. She wants more at a living than a trailer house with an adolescent husband for a drunken spouse. Oh, but it seems that's the way it goes. Now her lips are cracked from the burning sun, and she wants to flee, but her legs won't run. Sometimes she cries when the day is done. Take me down where the water's deep, down to the river where the water's sweet. Spill myself on your desert sand. I need filling up again. Come on, Lord, take me down where the water's deep, down to the river where the water's sweet. But don't drive on the desert sand. I need filling up again. Yeah. Oh, my bones are cracking and my blood's down turning to dust. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, I could use a big drink now. Oh, let me feel the cold wind raining down on me. Come on, take me down where the water's deep, down to the river where the water's sweet. Feel myself on your desert sand. I need filling up again. Take me down where the water's deep, down to the river where the water's sweet. Jack's gonna dive on the desert sand. I need filling up again. Yeah, fill me up. Yeah, yeah. Oh, come on, yeah, yeah, yeah. All right now, well, all right now. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
So that was the sounds of Bonepony. I've got Scott and Nick here. Guys, I appreciate you taking the time to join me. Nick, you're actually my first repeat guest after being on.
I don't even own a horse. I don't even own a horse, dude.
Right.
We do a lot of horse racing. Is that right?
We do a lot of horse racing. We had you on right after Derby last year, actually. So But guys, yeah, thanks for joining me. And so Nick, last time, you know, we talked a little bit about the band. We also talked a little bit kind of just your personal journey, you know, with music and becoming a musician. So want to maybe, Scott, give us a couple minutes on, I'm sure you could spend more than a couple minutes, but just kind of how you got the music bug and how you kind of got into everything.
Yeah, I grew up in a small town down in Texas and just was singing with my grandmother in church and had a voice, and she had a voice, and we just loved to sing together. And so as I got older and, of course, started listening to popular music and the Beatles and Rolling Stones and Led Zeppelin, and started trying to emulate the people that I looked up to, you know, Robert Plant and John Paul Jones and Paul McCartney, John Lennon, you know. So started trying to write songs at an early age and found myself in bands playing in pastor parties and, you know, getting busted by the police and that kind of thing. I said, you know what? I think I need to move to a larger town. So moved up to the DC area and played up there for a while. And then we started coming down to Nashville. One thing led to another, and somebody started paying us to write songs. And next thing you know, I was on a tour bus opening up for Bob Seger and Fleetwood Mac and ZZ Top and all these people that I idolized as a kid. And all these many years later, here I am still writing songs and singing stuff.
Yeah, that's really cool. I know my wife would love to hear that you opened for Fleetwood Mac. That's one of her all-time favorites.
At the Palace there in Louisville.
Oh, actually. Really?
Was one of the shows. We did several shows with them, but that was the first.
I love the Palace.
First time I'd been at the Palace, a beautiful theater.
Yeah, I mean, I've been in Kentucky almost my whole life. I've been in Louisville for almost 10 years, and last October was my first time going to the Palace. It was great. We went and saw Lake Street Dive, and it was a great show. Yeah, I mean, it's just a beautiful, beautiful venue.
Backstage is funky and old still, which I love.
Okay.
Love when videos, you know, are still the dressing room's kind of weird. Not all the light bulbs come on and that kind of thing.
I would guess probably kind of small and cramped back there.
Yeah, very much so. Yeah.
So, as far as Bonepony specifically, what are kind of the origins of the band, and you know, how did everything get started?
When I was up in Maryland, I met, played with several different groups, and you know, just had the little local rock mag that you know, the free newspaper and everything. I think I ran an ad in a free newspaper and met a guy named Brian Ward, and he and I kind of started Bonepony. He had a bunch of blues songs that were didn't have any lyrics to, they were unfinished, and I had a bunch of lyrics that didn't have any music to it, so we kind of got together that way. And we were more of a, you know, heavy metal band at the time. This was pre Guns N' Roses. You know, like More Than Words was out by Extreme,
yeah.
You know, those kind of bands. Those kind of, towards the tail end of the hair band era.
Okay.
And we were trying to do some of that, you know, heavy guitar, bass, and drums. But Nashville kind of saved us from all that. We started coming here. We had a deal with MCA where they'd let us record on the weekends. So we're driving down from Maryland to record, and what really seemed to stick with people at our live shows and in the recording studio was these acoustic songs that we had been tinkering around with, two-part harmony and stuff, like Lennon McCartney, you know, those types of songs, more singer-songwriter types of songs. So sure enough, that's what got people interested here, writers, publishing companies, and record labels and stuff. And so then Brian, once we did that initial record, Brian left right afterwards and Nick joined. I guess Nick and I've been playing for 25 years now together. Wow. And Brian actually had recorded guitar for the second record, and then Nick's been on everything after that. And just, I was lucky enough to play with two really incredibly talented instrumentalists, because I'm small hands and I can bang on stuff, but I'm not real dexterous. And this gentleman here can play just about anything. And so any ideas that we cook up, he can do them. And that's wonderful. Ryan was that way too. He was a real songwriter type of cat. And I think that's what helped Bonepony get over the hump and have a little identity from all the stuff that was going on at the time. It got us out of the hair band stuff, you know?
Yeah. So Nick, how did you find Scott, or how did he find you? Was another another ad, or how did you guys run into each other?
At that, by the time I joined, they'd already had a had their record deal, and they had a couple of huge tours, so they were established enough that Scott wasn't doing lowly things like handling musicians. there's a band called Walk the West that had some good success in the 80s that our Tramp, or at the time one of our players, had been a part of that band, and that John Goldman, the bass player for Walk the West, saw me, and he's like, man, I just happened to get a call from my friend that's in Bonepony, and they need a guitar player, and I think he'd be a good match for him. So we got together, and
knew immediately, as soon as Nick picked up the guitar and started just tuning it to all different kinds of things, I was like, oh, this guy gets it, so we were thick as thieves.
Just hearing Nick say the name of the band, and some people it's Bonepony and some people it's Bonepony. Where is the emphasis supposed to be there?
Emphasis.
Where is the emphasis?
Bonepony.
Bonepony. That's what it was supposed to be. No, it's just Bonepony. So we had some shows booked up in College Park, Maryland, where the University of Maryland is, and we didn't have a name. And the promoter was calling us saying, hey, we got to put something on these flyers that 10 people are for your show that is going to be attended by 10 people. And so we had an emergency meeting at the Pizza Hut down the street from rehearsal. And we cooked that up one night. And I always thought, well, we'll probably change the name. It's kind of a silly name, but it stuck, And then when we moved to Nashville, we started playing, Brian and I started doing two-man writer's nights all over the town. And people were like, you guys got a name? Do y'all call yourself? So I was like, Bonepony? And it just stuck, Next thing you know, it's actually, it's got Capitol Records on it. And there it is.
Yeah, so
be careful what you name yourself, because sometimes it stick,
Yeah, so you were just, for listeners that maybe not watching on YouTube, he was just showing us the vinyl copy, the re-release of Stomp Revival. So maybe talk about that process and what that's been like.
Yeah, 1995, the first record came out on Capitol Records. And of course, CD was the format at the time. And that was awesome. We got to put, a ton of music on there. It's a good format for holding a lot of music. Whereas the vinyl, you're 20 minutes per side. But growing up, I always listened to vinyl, and it's real romantic format, I thought. And I never realized that it was going to kind of come back into vogue again and be popular again. But we never got a chance to do that format. So, now that it's back and people are into it again, and we're coming up on the anniversary of sitting with the pandemic and, not playing out. We were in the studio quite a bit. I live real close to Nick, so he was part of my pandemic pod here and me his. And so we get together and just decided, let's just work on one song off the record. Let's work on the hardest one that would be to redo. A song called Soap. It's got a lot of parts in it, a lot of background vocals in it, a lot of real specific sounding parts. And I really wanted to copy it. I wanted to try to get those sounds and everything, not just the notes,
right, but
have everything sound like Stomp Revival. And the format was one of the reasons, but the other reason was none of the Stomp Revival stuff is streaming, because Capitol has all the rights to that. And that record was out way before anybody was streaming anything.
For all these years since it came out almost 30 years ago, we've never had the right to sell the recording of it, so we could play live all the time. So there's a lot of live versions out there.
Right.
And of course, we just had put out new records as the years went by, but it was, that's our flagship record, probably the biggest selling one, So, it was time to eventually, we knew eventually we would do it. Just 7 years after doesn't make any sense, So
right.
25 years made sense. Like, well, we've never owned the rights to the studio audio of it, so let's do that, like a lot of artists are doing the last couple of decades.
Taylor Swift redid hers. I thought, and it's been going on for a while. Thought that's a cool idea,
and I'm guessing
especially since we had the technology to do it,
I'm guessing from a technology and production standpoint, I'm guessing it's a lot easier to take an old vinyl record and remaster it onto CD or digital process than to go the other way. Maybe not.
It probably depends.
We had to make some choices about time. There's three songs on the CD that we couldn't put on the vinyl. So we're going to.
Yeah, it's 180 gram weight for anybody that's a vinyl enthusiast out there, audiophile. That's kind of the, you know, selling point for people. It's just heavier weight, so it lasts longer and supposedly, not supposedly, better sound quality.
Okay.
And the more music you put on a record, the more crowded those grooves are, that affects the quality. So a lot of the audiophiles kind of look for that. So if you're really trying to space it out, then you've only got that much. That's why they give you a range of, you know, so back in the day, some of these bands would just squish all kinds of stuff on there. And it's like, you know, but these days for people, because obviously the least convenient format for music, you know, so it's got a resurgence in popularity, but a lot of people want really good record players and they want to be 180 gram vinyls and, you know, that kind of stuff.
The higher fidelity, the better.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Sure.
We're gonna stream the final three songs. We recorded those over the last 6 months or so, and we're gonna stream everything.
So okay. It's only been available on our website as it is now on bonepony.com for the vinyl. Ships to U.S. only right now.
All right.
But the whole thing will come out on stream because everybody's been asking about that. That was always the plan, of course. But we thought we'd reward people that are supporting the band and keeping us in business by going straight to the website and ordering. One guy ordered 10 copies.
And he said he didn't have a record player.
Yeah, <that's right.
laughs> Just, you know, supporting the band, which is awesome. We've got great fans like that that have already supported just about everything we've done, you know, T-shirts and posters and the whole nine yards. So,
So I know Nick and I talked a little bit last time just about, you know, different places you guys have played and different venues. What about just there in Nashville? Are there one or two places, you know, closest to your hearts or that are most special to you guys just in that area?
Yeah, we got to play the Ryman one time, which was incredible. It was on a bill with several other artists, but I still count it. We were on stage with Steve Earle, and I've actually been there twice. I the first time was with a gospel choir, and that was pretty incredible. So we did a Bonepony song, and then I got to come back out and join the gospel choir, and you know, raise the roof with the choir. That was fun. But as far as venues that we often play.
Yeah, well, we did the Exit Inn last year, which was it was the first time in almost 20 years. We had some huge shows in 2001, you know, the turn of the century. That sounds weird. Sell it out. And it was just nuts. You know, there's still somebody sent me a screenshot of a newspaper. And that week it was like the ranch and it was Keith Urban were playing for like $5 a head and Sutler. Dirks Bentley was playing downtown for $3. You know, the big Bonepony show was $20.
Sold out. There you go.
You know, so that was special for us to go back and do a double bill last year at the.
It's got some historic relevance. Johnny Cash has played there. The Police have played there. The Chili Peppers have played there. I mean, a lot of bands up and coming, you know, come through Nashville and play. That was the Rock Club. Yeah. But they, you know, Lucinda Williams has played there. And so it's just one of those iconic Nashville places. Thank goodness it's still here. We've lost a lot of them.
50 years or something like that.
But, yeah.
And Third and Lindsley has been kind of our frequent place the last 20 years, probably, I guess.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. It's more of a sit down place, but it's still a great venue. And it grew. It used to be quite a bit smaller. Little corner stage. And we played they do a Sunday night show there with the WRLT. Which is a radio station.
Simulcast kind of thing.
Yeah, I've been real supportive, and they do a live thing there. But the venue got bigger. It's really a showcase place now. Ron Bryce is fantastic. You've known Ron for years, and he's always
owner.
Been super, super supportive and owner. And during the pandemic, he says, calls us up. He says, we've got protocol. You got to wear a mask and take temperature and stuff. But you guys want to do like a Tuesday night, play every Tuesday night. And so we did, and we worked up new music with that, and we got our old bass player back from early days. Jason Dunaway is playing bass with us again. Okay. And so we got to put that together at Third and Lindsley, which was fantastic.
Very cool.
Ron kind of thinking out of the box and just called us up out of the blue, and you know, it was underattended because of the pandemic, but you know, it beats sitting in a rehearsal hall. You know, being on stage is way better than rehearsing in a barn somewhere. So
it did relaunch us kind of with we've had different lineups because trying to make a living on it as a touring band. Sometimes people just don't want to be on the road. So that reunited us since we don't tour nearly as much anymore. And don't want to, you know. We have, so now our dates are kind of all over the place, lots of fly dates coast to coast, and then some runs here and there. So in festivals or private stuff. So it's scattered throughout the country, but not every single week like we did for decades, you know. So we got to reconnect with our Jason, that, as you mentioned, was the bass player in the 90s era. We've had a few reunions with him, just like once every 7-8 years as a one-time deal. And the guy that I replaced, Brian Ward, the founder of Wood Scott, mm-hmm. that co-wrote a lot of the stuff, has been doing some of the shows with us for the first time in 20-something years. We've got Tramp, who's a Kentucky guy, the last couple for many years now, that you may know. Okay. Done some of them with us. We have the drummer from the Screaming Cheetah Wheelies that I was in a band with in the 90s, 30 years ago. Terry Thomas comes out. So we got,
that was actually our first tour when we were out with Capitol Records. They put us with the Screaming Cheetah Wheelies. And so it's kind of come full circle in some ways, you know, these folks that still play music and, you know, like to have a good time and share similar senses of humor and similar family dynamics, to where you don't want to be out, you know, 260 dates a year. Right. But we still love to play. We absolutely still love to play.
We still do private stuff, but just me and Scott, some of the two-man shows every once in a while. But for the most part, we try to bring the full lineup out these days. It's definitely two of us and a couple of those guys at least. And we got a big one in Jasper, Indiana at the end of April.
April 27th.
At the Astra Theater.
I think that's
April 27th. Yeah. Check our website.
It's great to bring the guys because it's a good representation of what we've recorded. In the studio, you can bring in Bobby Keys and he'll play saxophone for you or something, which we've done in the past. But a lot of the times it's two man, and those are great as well. But always wonderful to have someone on the keys, mm-hmm. someone on the drums, someone playing these extra instruments that it sounds the way that we recorded it. So
yeah, well, your shows are always so much fun and good energy. And Nick, I can't remember if I told you this story last time or not, but when I was coaching soccer at Western, there was one year our final game was down at Middle Tennessee and you guys were in Bowling Green. My plan was get off the bus, go to the show. I wasn't feeling well during the game. I wasn't feeling well when I got home. I was like, I really want to go, but I can't. And woke up the next morning and I was like, I think it's my appendix. So I called my sister at like 7 a.m. and I said, Kelly, I need you to take me to the ER. And she was still half asleep, and she knew my plan the night before was to come see you guys. And she just goes, if you need me to take you to your car because you got too drunk seeing Bonepony, I'm not coming to get you right now. And I said, no, not my car, the ER. She's like, oh, okay, I'll be there in a second. Yeah, but it's kind of like, I know what you said you were going to be up to. I've seen this story before, and I'm not helping you with this. So
What year was this?
Oh, that would have been like 2010, somewhere in there. I got somewhere around there. I got back to coach in 2007. It was somewhere.
Oh, you were the coach too.
Yeah, it was somewhere early in my career there. But yeah, I was like, no, not my car. Yeah, but she knew the stories, and she was like, no, if you had too much fun with Bonepony and you can't get your car, you can worry about that later.
So you had a reputation, like, you know, Western Kentucky folks, they don't like to party or anything.
No, it's all strictly academic.
Absolutely. Got to get your degree.
But guys, I really appreciate your time and hanging out here, and glad I got to have my son listen at the beginning. But it's been fun, but we're starting to run a little short on time. So I don't know if you have one more you want to play to take us out. Yeah.
It's still a little jubilee.
Perfect.
This is what he was doing in that rehearsal, just turning it all kinds of ways. Song about celebration.
Jubilee. Well, get up, come on, let's go, let's take it a little higher. The roof won't raise unless you make it so, we
It's always fun listening to Bonepony, whether in person or through the marvels of modern technology. I thank Nick and Scott for their time in joining me. If you are in the Kentuckiana area, try to catch their show at the end of April. You can find more information about that and the re-release of Stomp Revival at bonepony.com. As always, I appreciate you listening to the Tin Man Podcast. Be sure to follow us or subscribe on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, or wherever you find your favorite podcast. You can also follow on X and Instagram at Tin Man Pod or check out our Facebook page. I'm Chris Tinius, and we'll catch you on another episode of the Tin Man Podcast.